This is a demonstration of the geotechnical capabilities of LUSAS. I'm going to be looking at the stage construction of a tunnel using the cut and cover technique. As well as the walls and slabs of this tunnel, it also features two ground anchors used to support the sides of a tunnel. In this model, the geometry has already been defined and has already been subdivided into our finite element mesh. I've also defined and assigned various attributes, such as the material and cross-sectional properties. And if we look at the soil property, we can see that I've used the K0 initialization option in order to start the analysis with the correct at-rest soil pressures. The restraints in this model are a transverse support on the sides, and both vertical and transverse support at the base of the soil block that we've modelled. Although not covered in this demonstration, in a real model, it should be checked whether we've modelled these boundaries sufficiently far away from our structure by carrying out checks with the supports moved further away. I've predefined load cases for the stages of the construction sequence. We're currently looking at the first load case, which we want to be the undisturbed site. But as we can see, we've actually already got structural elements in for the tunnel. And this is because LUSAS assumes that any elements are active right from the very start, unless you tell it otherwise. So what we can do is we can go to Attributes, Activate and Deactivate, and define a deactivation attribute. If we then select the concrete walls and select the steel anchors, we can assign the deactivation attribute in the first load case. Our second load case is to install the piles. So for this, we want to create an activation attribute. And if we assign that, we can assign it in a second load case in order to activate those piles. We're then going to dig out the top of the soil using a deactivation attribute. Install the ground anchors by activating them. Dig further. Activate the tunnel walls and slabs. And then finally, we're going to reactivate the soil at the top. When it is reactivated, it has forgotten the stresses back from when it was deactivated, and so it's been reactivated with zero initial stress. As this is a stage construction analysis, with which parts of the model being active or inactive changing from one load case to another, that means the stiffness matrix is changing. Within LUSAS, we therefore treat that as a nonlinear analysis. I'm going to use this displacement reset option. It will allow us to ignore any deflections which occur under the self-weight of soil in load case 1 while we're setting up the initial state, and therefore any deflections we see later on are only ones which have happened since we started our actual construction sequence. We can then add self-weight loading to every load case by right-clicking on analysis 1 and going to add gravity, and we can now see the blue arrows in every load case telling us that we've included gravity. And we can then solve in order to get results. So looking at the results here, we're looking at stress within the soil, and we're starting with load case 1. As we can see, we've got horizontal bands of stress, with the stress increasing the further down we go. As we go through the construction, we can see how the stress within the soil is changing. What we can see here at maximum depth of excavation is we can see heave occurring within the soil. Our next stage is to switch to using a nonlinear Moore Coulomb soil material, where we've defined our plastic Moore Coulomb properties, and also once again we've got K0 initialization turned on. What I'm going to do is I'm going to copy analysis 1 and paste it in order to create a copy analysis, which we'll call analysis 2, nonlinear. We can select everything that's got the linear soil material in analysis 1 and apply the nonlinear soil material in analysis 2. This means that our analysis 1 linear soil results will still remain within the model, and we can compare them to our analysis 2 nonlinear soil results. We can solve to get results. As you can see, it only needs to solve analysis 2 because analysis 1 results are up to date. Looking at the results from the nonlinear analysis, we can see we're getting the same sort of results happening. If we wanted to, we could look at the difference in the results between the linear soil and the nonlinear soil by using a basic combination. So we could take the results from, let's say, the maximum excavation from the linear analysis, compare it to the maximum excavation from the nonlinear analysis by doing the results of analysis 1 minus the results of analysis 2. And if we look at these results, we can see some fairly significant differences in the stress calculated by the two different analyses. We can also do a stability check using the Phi-c soil strength reduction method at any stage within the construction. I'm going to create one by doing a new branch at the point of maximum excavation, and it's going to be a branch type of Phi-c reduction. I then need to define a Phi-c reduction attribute and choose which parts of the model to assign it to. I'm going to look at the right wall failing, and therefore I'm going to assign the soil strength reduction mainly to the right-hand side of the model. For a real project, it should also be checked for symmetrical failure by assigning the Phi-c attribute to the whole model in another separate branch. We can now solve to get results. And we can see here that failure has occurred when it's decreased the strength of the soil by a factor of 1.432. So we have a safety factor of 1.432 against this sort of failure. I'm also going to consider a live load being driven across the structure using this line to define the path of the vehicle. I've used a search area of the top of the soil to tell LUSAS that the vehicle load can only be applied to these elements. I'm going to put this loading at the end of analysis 1 in a new branch off the final load case. I'm going to select the line that's going to define the path of my vehicle and go to Bridge, Moving Load, select this vehicle which I've previously defined in the model. It can only be assigned load to the top of the soil, project onto line for a 2D model. I'm going to try that vehicle every 2 meters. LUSAS then automatically creates a series of load cases with the vehicle in multiple different positions, basically driving it over the structure. It's also by default created an envelope with all of these load cases in it, which I'm just going to rename now. And I'm then going to solve to get results. And we can see here the stresses from having the vehicle in this particular location. And as we can see, they're relatively small compared to those experienced during the construction sequence. So far, we've only been looking at the stresses in the soil, but we can also get structural results out by turning on the diagram layer to look at bending moments within the structural elements.